Okay, welcome back to this introduction to machine learning for material science. This is section two, where we'll be walking through feature generation. So if I scroll down to the outline here, we can see last time we went through a little bit of data inspection. We took our data set, we cleaned it up. We looked at what is the data we have available to us and how that might inform our decision-making later on. Now we'll look at feature generation, which is how we can take the data set and get it into a format that we could directly use for machine learning. So the key thing that we need to do with this feature generation is figure out what is the actual inputs that we're going to use for the model. So previously, if I scroll back up, when we looked at our data set, I'll go up a little bit more here. The columns that we have available to us right now at the top here is we have the chemical formulas, we have the band gap values, and then we have a little bit of metadata about, you know, where were the experiments made, what was the methodology, how reliable were they, you know, where did the units were using, stuff like that. But the two key ones that we are interested in really are in the chemical formula and the band gap values. So the values are what we're trying to predict, and they're considered, you know, the output of our model, whereas the chemical formula is what we're going to use as the input. And right now what we have this in is just in as the, you know, formulas for, you know, what are the elements present and how frequently are they present. And, you know, we might say, you know, why can't we just, you know, feed that directly into a machine learning model? And the issue there is that, you know, by default, machine learning models basically, you know, they need number inputs. They need something that is not using a bunch of text or a bunch of letters. We need some way to represent these chemical formulas in, you know, purely a numerical way. And the way that we're going to do that is we're going to take advantage of the fact that we actually know a lot about properties of the elements in the materials. So if we say, you know, we have a material with, you know, lithium in it, we know a lot about lithium. So if we say, if we replace lithium by a representation of the properties of lithium, that might give us a bunch of information about what this material is, and hopefully allow us to predict, again, the band gap of the material. So if I scroll down, that's the basic outline of what this section is all about, and we'll go through how we actually do that. So first, what we're going to do is we're going to read back in the data set that we created, our clean version of the data set previously. There is a section here which right now I'm going to keep commented out, and this is what will actually generate the features for us. Right now it's commented out because, one, this will run faster. I already generated these previously, and again, if you're following along at home, these are also generated for you previously at home. So you can just run through these, and if you want to go back and uncomment these and try to run them, you can. But I think right now it'll be faster and easier if we skip them and go through and see what the results are of it. So what we could have done here is run a separate tool called MAST-ML, which is a software package that builds a lot of these material science machine learning workflows together, and will do this generation for us. What we're going to do is, you know, say we've already run that, and we're going to look at, you know, what exactly happened. So if we go through and read in the results here, you see it's from this generated features folder, and it's this generated features.csv file that we're going to look at. So we're going to read them in, and we're going to build up some new data frames and look at, you know, what are the features that we can generate. So this is the previous data set we had again. So we have our formula, we have our band gap values. And here's what happens when we take, again, these formulas and we start looking at what are the elemental properties that are in here. So right now we have things like the atomic number. So we're looking at the composition average of the atomic number. So again, if I go up here and I said, you know, what is the atomic number of the different elements that are present, and just average between them, that'll give me this value in this column here. And we can do that for all the properties that we know about the elements. So we have atomic number, atomic radii, the volume, atomic weight. A lot of these are fairly simple and easy to understand. There's some that are a little more complex. So if I start scrolling to the right here, you'll see there's, you know, a very large amount of these. We have things like thermal conductivity, specific heat capacity, and then we have, you know, things that are a little more complex to understand. So there's things like the ionization energy, but again, these are all just things that describe, you know, what are the elements present, what are things we know about the elements. And hopefully this is going to give us information about the banknote. As I mentioned earlier, the key thing here is that now we have a description of all the materials, but it's not in a kind of text format. Now it's purely, numbers that represent the materials. So we have, this exact same number of rows that we had previously. So each of these rows, again, is for each data point that we have. So if I scroll down to the bottom here, we have 467. And then we have the exact same thing here, 467. So we have, for each training point that we're going to try to train our model on, we have this description of this is the information we know about the point. So we're going to use this data set basically as our input to try to predict this column here, which is the Baghdad column. So that's the key setup for everything that we're going to do next. And overall, this is very kind of quick and dirty. Again, most of it sort of happened behind the scenes. There's a section here which goes through one specific example in case you're a little bit confused about, what exactly happened here. And it goes through this example for the atomic number. So if you're feeling a little confused and you want to take a little more time to dig through that, I encourage you to work through the exercises included here. And the next section that we're going to go through is feature engineering. So this is how we take the features that we just generated and we start to change them a little bit to hopefully make them more useful. So right now we could kind of skip this step and dive directly into building a model. The feature engineering is a step where we sort of take a step back and we say, okay, what can we do to improve the features that we've just generated, make them more useful for the machine learning. So with that, we will stop for section 2 and I'll pick up next time for feature engineering.